Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the 28th meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome members, our witnesses and those in the gallery, and can I remind everyone please to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. We have apologies this morning from Joanne Lamont and Chick Brodie, and we have two members running late, Patrick Harvey and John McAlpin, who should be with us shortly. Item one on the agenda, we are continuing to take evidence in relation to Scotland's budget 2016-17 and are conducting pre-budget scrutiny, and we're hearing today from two enterprise agencies. And I'd like to welcome to the first panel Alex Paterson, who is the Chief Executive of Highlands and Islands Enterprises, joined by Forbes Duthie, Director of Finance and Corporate Services. So welcome to you both. We have about an hour for this. We need to suspend at around 10:45 for the remembrance commemoration. And there's a number of issues I think members want to cover in that time. And if I could remind members to keep their questions as short and to the point as possible, and answers as short and to the point as possible, would be helpful in terms of covering the topics in the time available. I wonder if I could just start off asking you a little bit about the process in terms of the budget. We're in a slightly unusual position this year because the budget is late for reasons that are well understood. We now believe the budget will be published on the 16th of December. I wonder if you could just explain to us how that will affect your budget process and what sort of timescale you're looking at to get your own budget finalised for the coming year.
Sure. So, well, thank you for the invitation to meet you again. Good to be here. You're right, we're in a slightly different, maybe unusual situation this time of the year, in the sense we don't yet have a budget for next year. So I guess there's a number of things that we are doing to prepare for whatever budget might come our way. And then there's the process which you outlined, which I'll mention. I mean, in terms of the budget, I mean, we honestly do not know what our budget for next year will be. You'll have seen in our operating plan that we projected forward for 16-17 and 17-18 the budget we've got in the current year. But we know that all organisations will probably be asked to look closely at their budgets. And so internally, we're doing some planning, scenario planning on different situations. In terms of the process, we'll be engaging with our sponsor team over the coming weeks leading up to the budget announcement to get clarity on what our 16-17 budget will be. That will then form an integral part of our business planning process for 2016-17, which the High Board will consider in the new year and leading up to the publication of our operating plan for the year, hopefully by the end of March next year. So we are in a wee bit of a hiatus position, not being clear. Clearly, we have quite a number of commitments, because in the sort of business that we're in, you make commitments that are multi-year. So we're carefully managing those at the moment to make sure that you know, whatever scenario emerges from the budget discussions, then we're well placed to handle. But Forbes may want to see a wee bit more detail on that from the finance point of view.
Yeah, but I think really where we are in terms of, as Alex said, we have run some scenarios in terms of budget alterations which may come our way, and the reality is over the sort of the past 10 years, HIE's budget has had a degree of volatility in it. So we are used to both budget increases and budget reductions. So we will adapt and manage to the process as we can. As Alex rightly said, we do have a number of large projects, and we do have obviously, you know, numerous small projects, and we work closely with our clients, particularly the large ones, in terms of the phasing of those projects, the phasing of expenditure, so we can build some flexibility into our budget as required. The committee will also be aware of issues at the strategic forum savings, which are a regular feature in our discussions. We've delivered those over the last 3 years, and indeed a number of those savings are recurring. So in expectation of a new budget that it won't have strategic forum savings perhaps, then there's a recurring element already built into our budget, which we'd hope to use for expansion and development, shall we say, but could actually be used to cover some cuts. So we do have a number of plans and thoughts in our minds which may be required, shall we say, if the budgets are reduced in any way.
Sure. Okay. Thank you. Just looking at your financial overview, there are four kind of key strands of spending: supporting businesses and social enterprises, strengthening communities of fragile areas, developing growth sectors, and competitive and low carbon region. I mean, if there were a substantial change in the budget, either up or down, are there any of those areas likely to be more or less affected by that?
So I think two thoughts on that. There are certain things that are easier for us to flex. So large projects, particularly those at our own hand, ones that we are delivering, there is more scope to flex or to phase than those projects led by the private sector that we've already committed to. So of those categories, probably the bottom two are the ones where we've got more scope to tweak things ourselves. Having said that, however, you know, one of the things, and I remember saying to this committee many years ago, one of the things we try and do is, you know, we find alternative sources of funds as well. So we have new structural funds programmes coming through, which we're going to be using to invest in a number of activities. We're investing in new ways of delivering some of our services. So one of the things we've done over recent years is make a very significant investment in digital technology. And that is having a big impact on how we deliver our business and how we affect savings in terms of our operating costs. But in terms of your general question, the ability for us to tweak or to adjust budgets will be largely around large projects that we control the delivery of.
Okay, thank you for that. I wonder if I can ask another question on a slightly different topic. The committee has been doing an inquiry into fair work, looking at quality of work issues, wages, terms and conditions, and so on. We've just concluded taking evidence on that, but one of the interesting issues that's come up in relation to that whole inquiry is to what extent enterprise agencies look at these issues when they're agreeing to support projects, for example, from foreign direct investors. Is this something you've come up against as an agency? Is there any particular view you have in terms of when you're looking at a potential foreign direct investment, or not even foreign direct investment, an investment from anyone in the area? Do you look at these quality of work issues? Does that affect your judgment on whether or not such projects will get support?
Yes, we do. And it's not just about creating jobs, it's just about creating quality of jobs. One of the indicators we monitor is the salary levels associated with the jobs that we support the creation of. And we know from our analysis of that that the jobs that we support are at a higher level than the average salaries for jobs across the region or in the localities in which they are based. There are some industries where clearly the wages are lower than we perhaps like, but as an organisation, we are definitely focused on creating jobs, but good quality jobs. And I guess with the increased focus on fair work, with the business pledge, with the whole inclusive growth agenda, that has even more focus now than arguably it had in the past. So it is very much part of what we do. And all our account managers dealing with all our account managed companies are active in bringing to the attention of their businesses and social enterprises and communities the fair work agenda, the business pledge and its obligations. So it's absolutely the heart of what we do.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Okay, I'm going to bring in Dennis Robinson.
And good morning. And maybe just to follow up before I go into one question here, when the convener was asking about the areas that you look at before entering into contracts, do you look at companies that would be sort of possibly trying to ensure that there's no one using zero-hour contracts? And again, do you look at some of the ethical questions around support, especially within the foreign investment?
Yes, I mean, in terms of the zero-hour contracts as an employer, we have no zero-hour contracts. And as part of the business pledge rollout, then the zero-hour contracts is an important part of that. So the whole fair work agenda in its various dimensions is an important part of what we do. I would, in terms of the ethical, I can't think of a situation that we've had in recent times where the ethical issue has arisen, in sense of there being potentially activity which we would think would be questionable to support. I'm not sure if Forbes can think of one either, but certainly it would be a factor if it ever arose.
Good, thank you very much.
I was going to ask you, you've got ambitions to still be a leader with regard to marine technology, both offshore, wind, wave, tidal. Perhaps you could maybe explain it just a little further in terms of what your ambition is in meeting your targets, and especially with the low carbon area within your statements and the evidence that you've submitted. And maybe outline any of the challenges that you have, because obviously it's an area that is still subject to a lot of, we'll just say challenges at the moment.
Sure. So we've had the view for a long time that Scotland and the north of Scotland is incredibly well positioned in the whole marine renewables, the whole renewable energy sector. I think what we've seen in recent times is that the speed of development, the speed with which these things come through, has probably it's probably taking longer than perhaps we all anticipated. But we are still hugely committed and hugely positive about the marine renewables opportunity. So, for example, the investment that's been made by us and others on ports and harbours and infrastructure across the region makes it incredibly well placed to handle the offshore wind projects as they build out. We have invested, and many others have invested over many years, in wave and tidal developments. Now, you can see the Magen project building out in the Pentland Firth, the first commercial tidal array, which is fantastic news. We've had some bumps on the road with wave, but we've created Wave Energy Scotland, which is now supporting innovative investment in wave technology, which in turn, or in time, we hope will lead to commercially deployable devices. So we remain very committed to and very optimistic about the prospects for marine renewables. The challenges just now, I think that maybe there are two. One is the timescale it's taking for all of this to move forward, but there are some reasons for that. And I think the second thing which is challenging just now is just the regulatory environment in which all of this has been taken forward, with renewable obligations and lack of certainty of when the auctions for contracts for difference and feed-in tariffs and so on might come in. So that uncertainty is undoubtedly affecting some of the thinking at the moment. But that aside, we remain very optimistic and committed to offshore wind opportunities, which are there and imminent. We can see the tidal devices being deployed, and wave energy, well, we'll have to take a step back to actually hopefully move forward over the coming years.
Yeah, it does sound very challenging. I'm just wondering, you mentioned the renewable obligation here, and has the announcements from the Westminster, have you had discussions with any potential investors that have made a decision not to invest because of the uncertainty or because of the announcements with regard to the renewable obligations?
I can't say I've personally had discussions with people who have decided not to invest. What I have had are conversations with businesses who would just like there to be certainty. And one said to me, even if the regime or the environment we end up with is not one we would particularly want or like, at least we're clear what the framework actually is. So it's the uncertainty, I think, that's the issue. And the sooner we can get clarity on that, then the better. But I'm not aware of people deciding not to invest. It's more a case of we might just be sitting still a wee bit until we are clearer on what the environment might look like.
What can you do to try and attract investors at the moment, given that the recent announcement from Amber Rudd that there's a possibility that they may be supporting renewables outside the UK but withdrawing the obligations within the UK?
Well, clearly we would want there to be some certainty around what the UK situation is. I mean, what are we doing? There are many organisations, some of the Beatrice field will be built out, but there's others looking at the Morrow project, which would benefit from a contract for difference auction. We're continuing to work with these businesses. We're doing a lot of work in supply chain and helping local companies be ready. We've invested, as I said a minute ago, with others in significant infrastructure projects. So when decisions are taken, we are ready to go. Nothing else really needs to be done in terms of major investments. The facilities are there, such as at NIG, such as at Invergordon, to take advantage of these opportunities. So clarity in the regulatory regime would be helpful, but that's a wee bit out of our control. But clearly my energy team and others and Scottish Government ministers are picking that up with the UK Government, but we continue to work on the basis that good projects are there, positive decisions will be taken. We want to make sure that Scottish companies and Highlands and Islands companies and facilities are as well placed as they possibly can be to pick up that business.
Excellent. Just with regard to the budget, how much are you, have you currently invested within the last budget year, and how much are you prepared to invest in the forthcoming 16-17?
In energy.
In energy.
Yeah, we have that figure. Do you have it? Well,
I think through Wave Energy Scotland, the figure we're talking about for next year would be 13 million. There are a number of other projects in renewables as well, which I don't have the exact figure, but it's probably in the region of sort of £5-7 million, which is quite significant, obviously, within the scale of budget that we have.
Within that renewable area, in terms of the spend, is that onshore? Are you looking at onshore and offshore investment?
Yeah, so our investment in energy is going into either businesses in the sector through our business support, or it's going into infrastructure, whether it's ports and harbours, things like that. We're not investing in wind farms or that type of facility. So it's into the businesses and infrastructure in the Highlands and Islands that will support the energy sector. The figure this year, I think, for a half year is around about sort of three-ish million from memory, which is a bit less than last year and the year before. And that probably reflects that over the last couple of years, we have made very significant investments in, you know, ports and harbours such as at Nigg, such as at Scrabster, such as at Invergordon. So, you know, you don't continue necessarily with that. I guess my argument is you don't necessarily have to have the same level of spend every year, because some of the major investments have been made. But certainly around Wave Energy Scotland, around the Maygen project up in the Pentland Firth, investment continues. And I guess the other just thing in energy at the moment is with the downturn in oil and gas, then we're spending a lot of time working with our businesses who are being affected to some extent by the oil and gas downturn. We have about 80 account managed businesses who derive at least some of their income from that sort of sector. So we're doing a lot of work understanding their situation, how we can help them diversify into new areas of opportunities. Those sort of activities don't necessarily carry the multi-million pound price tags that ports and harbour investments might have.
Multi-million pound price tags in terms of ensuring that you're looking at low carbon targets and trying to obviously encourage more renewables. When you're doing new build, whether that be school campuses, etc., are you deploying the renewables into those sectors as well within your new builds within the area? So would you be using solar, or would you be looking at any sort of form of wind generation, any new builds?
Yeah, yes, we are. So every new build that we undertake, we want to get, you know, BREEAM, you know, standard, excellent standard. If I took you to the new Inverness campus, it is a renewable energy driven campus. We've got, you know, suds for the drainage system and everything else there. I don't think we've installed a turbine on any of our buildings, but certainly where possible, maximising the use of renewable sources of energy is a fundamental part of what we do.
Yeah. Well, we do have a number of buildings where we do have some solar panels and such like, but It's not widespread as yet. Our priority has been to fund the industry and the infrastructure. And
lastly, convener, for me, is the charge regime to the grid. Is that something that you find still very challenging and would like to see readdressed, obviously to take forward some of the projects in the future?
Yes, I might. I might offer to sort of come back to you with a specific view on the charging mechanism. I mean, all I would say to this morning is that certainly the charging mechanism or the charging regime for energy generated in the periphery has been an issue, and grid connections and grid capacity continues to be an issue. So yes, the more we can facilitate access to the grid for some of the developments, particularly in the islands, you know, the better it would be.
Accessibility to the grid, is it? It's about meeting the cost.
Yes.
The extortionate, exactly, unfair regime that is in place.
Not always expressing an opinion or anything, but the convener on the matter.
I take that opinion as a statement rather than
a
question.
I was making a statement. I think it's a statement of fact, actually, you know, rather than an opinion. Thanks, convener.
As we know, this committee has considered these issues on many occasions. Okay, I'll bring in Lewis McDonald, who's got a follow-up.
Thank you very much. Just to follow up the energy questions a little bit, you mentioned the impact of the downturn in oil and gas, and I think you said 80 businesses, account managed businesses across the Highlands and Islands. There are some obvious risk areas. Have you done, as an agency, an assessment of the impact of the downturn on the economy of the Highlands and Islands as a whole?
We're doing it currently. We know from data from Skills Development Scotland, there's about 2,300 redundancy notices have been issued to workers in the sector in the Highlands and Islands. Close to 900 of those we understand are associated with construction projects that may be coming to an end, but there's still a significant number there. And we know from our own monitoring of businesses, then there's probably another 190 sort of jobs that we think are probably at risk. So it's not in any way insignificant. What we're doing a particular bit of work on the impact in Shetland, because most of these redundancy notices have been in Shetland. So we have commissioned an economic impact assessment, which, subject to all the information and all the key players been able to get information to us, we hope to have concluded close to the end of this month, but that is underway at the moment.
That's helpful, and Shetland, in fact, was one of the things I was going to ask you about, because clearly there's been some very disappointing developments in regard to decisions made by major oil companies in relation to landfall for hydrocarbons and so on. The other island issue that I was interested in your view on, fabrication at our nation's Stornoway, which I know well. Mm-hmm. I know that fabrication sector is under significant pressure, but there are also presumably significant opportunities on the renewable side for some of those jobs and skills to be redeployed. Would you comment on that, both in relation to Arnish and also Shetland, and also how you're looking ahead as to how you can promote that kind of skills transfer in the next 12 months?
So I think in terms of Arnish, I mean, Arnish is now quite a terrific site in terms of the investment that's been made in preparing it. It's been challenging in terms of its marketing and if you like, populating it. We have one anchor tenant there, and I think there's more than one. There's one in the oil, in the energy sector who's got a presence there. And I think Arnish at the moment is you know, suffering from the wider issues or ails in the sector. We see Arnish as an important location for certainly energy and marine opportunities, but perhaps wider than that. So we are actively promoting it. We have some current interest in it. So I think Arnish is well placed, partly for renewables, but also partly for, you know, west of Shetland oil and gas developments, which, you know, perhaps play to West Coast ports going forward. On the issue of the skills, you know, what's happened, I guess, as a sort of side effect of the oil industry is that many people have become available. So we know of some companies, up in Caithness and elsewhere, where recruitment has traditionally been quite difficult, are now actually been able to recruit. The unseen effect of the oil and gas is that it's not just a number of people. Many of the people who work offshore come from across the Highlands and Islands. So it's the effect back into local communities of people who have maybe lost their jobs, or the income isn't coming back as much as it might have been. But we have seen quite a number of jobs created. We're working with Skills Development Scotland whenever situations arise to look at opportunities. But it's undoubtedly having an effect. And the economic impact assessment of Shetland, where it's particularly focused, will actually give us a good handle on, you know, what more we need to do.
But in terms of the budget priorities you've identified, would it be fair to assume that the work, the energy budget, if you like, the work that you're doing on renewables is side by side with work on oil and gas and dealing with the impact of that?
Yes, I mean, our work in oil and gas will be primarily working with businesses in the sector. And we're doing some work with SDI just now, looking at international opportunities for oil and gas companies and so on. So that's largely where that will come from. Our work in the renewable sector is partly based on what we've done to date in terms of infrastructure development, and it's partly based on things such as Wave Energy Scotland and so on, taking forward new innovative ideas that hopefully will underpin the sector going forward.
Thanks very much.
Okay. Gordon MacDonald's got a follow-up on energy, and I'll come back to you. Yeah.
It was just a comment that was in the article this week by the BBC on the new Highlands at 50. And in referring to energy, it had two comments. One was, bear in mind that there's more and more focus in renewables. It refers to the HIE sunk boreholes near Brora in search of coal seams. And I'm just wondering, you know, what that was about. And secondly, it refers to the possible energy from the North Sea. There was some study about the Moray Firth Industrial Credibility Study. I'm just wondering if you could just say something about possible energy from the North Sea and why you were sinking boreholes for coal in Brora.
The convener asked me to be brief in my responses. You know, I'd like to know what we're doing with boreholes in Brora as well. I suspect it was way back in the early days or earlier days of HIDB. I can assure you it is not featured. I can assure you it is not, neither that nor the other one you referred to has featured in our business plans of recent times.
Okay. Well, if you do get any more information, perhaps you could, you could write it.
If it's right, Cole and Brora, you'll be the first to know.
Perfect. Just before we leave energy, I just wanted to follow up on one point that actually came up yesterday in the chamber to do with the Saltire Prize. Fergus Ewing told us yesterday the Saltire Prize cannot now be won because there will be no company and will meet the qualifying criteria for it to be awarded by the date of 2017. He was talking about the Scottish Government and its advisers looking at reshaping the prize, and there was some discussion about whether that, instead of spending £10 million on that prize, whether the money might be better spent in other ways to try and support the green energy. Is it something that HIE have any particular view on?
To be honest, it's not something I've been close to, okay. I would hesitate to offer a view. I mean, I think all I would say is that, you know, clearly we've seen the government supporting new initiatives like Wave Energy Scotland in recent times. So, I mean, I think important to review things that are perhaps not working as maybe envisaged and direct the money elsewhere. But on the specifics of the Saltire Prize, I'm not sufficiently briefed to offer more than that.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, I'll go back to Lewis MacDonald.
Yes, I just want Gordon MacDonald mentioned the new Highlands at 50, and I thought, as you had referred to it yourselves in your submission, it might be appropriate to comment on 50 years since the creation of the Highlands and Islands Development Board. I think your submission says that there has been a transformation in those 50 years, which I think is absolutely right. But I wonder if you would summarise that and also say, looking forward, what HIE sees as the future development of economic and social change in the Highlands and Islands.
Thank you. So, yes, it was on the 1st of November 1965 that the HIDB was formed. And to sort of describe the transformation, maybe just characterise how things were in 65, they were summed up in the phrase called the Highland Problem, but it was largely huge and, you know, never-ending depopulation. Economic indicators such as unemployment and employment rates were well below Scottish figures. The industrial base was very narrow. And there had been a lack of investment in infrastructure over many preceding decades. So over the last 50 years, through the work of HIDB and High and local government and huge investment from government in infrastructure, you know, a number of things have changed. If you take population itself, it's increased by 22% over that period, and a large percentage of Scotland's population growth over that period of time has come through the Highlands and Islands. So we're sitting today at just under £470,000 people, which that's not our budget for next year. I hope. So population has grown. The industrial base has broadened out. Aquaculture and agriculture and tourism and food and drink are still vitally important, but we've now got an energy sector, a renewable sector, a life sciences sector, over 4,000 employed in business services. And in many of the economic indicators, whether it's unemployment or employment rates or youth unemployment, then the Highlands and Islands performance is better than the national averages, all of which I think is good. I was asked by a journalist last week, what do you think the biggest change has been? And I offer two. I think one is population, because that was the big issue. And I think the second one is perception. Because the perception back then was, if you want to get on in life, you get out of the Highlands. and the perception now is different. We've done some research amongst young people, and they're very much more positive about opportunities and careers and living in the Highlands and Islands. So there has been a significant transformation, and an infrastructure, we didn't have any of the causeways or the bridges back then that we have now. Undoubtedly helped by North Sea oil and other sort of things, but it's been helpful. In terms of going forward, what do I think the priorities are? Well, I offer you three thoughts. I mean, one is that not every part of the Highlands and Islands has enjoyed the same level of economic growth. So I'm acutely aware that there are areas, particularly in some of our more remote areas, that the benefits of development have not been equally shared. So we need to do more in those areas. I think the second thing is around not just population, but an aspect of population, which is the demographic challenges. We held a workshop this week attended by local authorities and many national and local agencies looking at our youth research and basically saying, how can we make the region more of a region for young people? Because we still have an imbalance in the demographic of the population. And the third thing I would simply say is, I don't think we're any longer trying to solve the Highland problem. I think what we're about is making sure that we seize Highlands and Islands opportunities. And that, whether it's digital, whether it's some of the new industry sectors that are coming through, needs to be our focus.
Thanks very much. Can I pursue one particular aspect of that? Well, I guess it affects at least two, if not all three, of the things you've highlighted there in looking forward. And that's the proposition of inclusive growth. And I wonder if you could tell us your understanding of that, how that applies to Highlands and Islands, and whether that involves simply a change in label or a change in title, or does it involve a change in the fundamentals of what you're seeking to do?
So, in one sense, I think a lot of the work that we've done over many years has probably been around inclusive growth, but there are new things as well. So you'll see in our submission, we probably define inclusive growth in a number of ways. There's geographic inclusion. So my comment a minute ago about some of the areas, particularly the more remote areas, not having the same rate of growth as other areas, then we need to try and address that. There are things around fair work and social issues. So we promote the business pledge and the wider fair work agenda. I see an awful lot of what we are doing around digital connectivity as part of inclusive growth, reducing the effect of distance and geography. I see the work we're doing around young people as part of the inclusive growth agenda as well. You know, I can talk about our graduate programme, but we've run an accelerator programme for creative industries where we've helped 200 youngsters, you know, move out of, you know, not having an opportunity and moving into career opportunities. The work we're doing around our strengthened communities work generally, working with communities in many of our most remote and fragile areas, is all around inclusive growth. But some of the stuff that is mainstream is also inclusive growth as well. So the work we do in businesses, investing in businesses to create jobs in some of our remoter areas, is all part of the inclusive growth agenda. I was out in Barra a few weeks ago, and we're supporting a new business out there, creating about 4 or 5 new jobs, which you do something similar in Inverness or Glasgow, it would equate to many more new jobs. That's inclusive growth in terms of helping those communities come together. So we define it quite broadly in terms of what we do, whether it's geographic or social or digital and so on. And clearly some of the new aspects are the promotion of the business pledge and the fair work agenda more overtly than perhaps were there before.
Thanks very much. And finally, as I guess part of that, the proposition of account managed communities, and you set an ambitious target for that, I think, of engaging 40 to 60 communities. You reached the 40, I wonder if you would comment on the success of that, on the challenges you face in extending it further, and how you see it rolling out in the future.
So as of today, we account manage 51 communities across the Highlands and Islands, so the number has increased. And I think what we've done in account management generally, including communities and social enterprises and businesses, is just refocused our account management approach. I think last time we spoke about the very positive valuation we had on account management. So we have extended that. The challenges, I think, are largely around capacity building. with communities. There's some fantastic examples out there from communities who are building houses, who are putting in leisure facilities in their harbours and a whole range of things. But we're investing quite considerably in community capacity building, helping these projects get off the ground and supplementing the skills and expertise that communities have. But we have grown our community account management from the 40 last year, and it's currently 51.
Thanks very much.
OK. Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. You mentioned the demographic imbalance, and you know, while it's fantastic that the population over the last 50 years in the Highlands has grown by about 90,000, in relation to the population itself, the same BBC article said the population is tilted towards the old and on course to becoming more so. I was just wondering what your views were on that, and also what effect of depopulation of the young is having on economic growth in the area and being able to attract companies and encourage those companies to grow.
I just missed your first point, the attracting companies I've got. What was your first point again?
In relation to the article by the BBC, yeah. They said the population is tilted towards the old and on course to becoming more so. Is that okay. Your view? And also, what effect is that having on economic growth in the area?
Okay, so in terms of that point, the demographics of the Highlands and Islands, not dissimilar to those of Scotland, are towards an elderly population. The demographic profile for the Highlands and Islands suggests a larger number of older. So, hence my comment about an increased focus around young people and attracting young people. And I have to say that the youth issue is improving. If you look over the last census period, you know, the number of youngsters who are leaving or think they have to leave is actually slowing down. Things like the University of the Highlands and Islands and rollout of broadband and all these things will help. In terms of the attractiveness of companies, my sense is that companies recognise that it may take a bit longer to recruit the high-skilled jobs you want, but you'll get them. And once you get them, your retention levels will be extremely good. And I could take you around a number of businesses where that has been their experience. So, look, we don't have a labour pool the size of Edinburgh, and it does take a bit longer, but our experience with some of the big companies in the life sciences sector and the business services and other sector is people are there, they're attracted to the Highlands and Islands. If you just give a bit more time, they will be there. And we had a small software company and create an office in Inverness, creating 17 software engineering jobs recently, who thought they could get that expertise in Inverness, and they managed to do it. But it just takes a bit longer, but you'll be rewarded with retention and commitment.
Right, that's good to hear. You mentioned the importance of digital rollout and super fast broadband in order to retain young people in the area. In your report, you mentioned there's 135,000 premises now have access to super fast broadband. What sort of proportion is that of the total premises in the Highlands and Islands?
Just over half, between 50% and 60%.
Right.
So I think it's closer to 140,000 premises now have access to super fast broadband. Close to 100 through the programme that we are running, and the balance through BT's commercial rollout. So it's moving quickly. The start of last year, 4% of premises in the Highlands and Islands had access to superfast broadband. Today, it's 54%. By the end of next year, it'll be at least 84%. So the growth and the coverage is massive. But to answer to your question, I found the exact number. It's 54% today.
And submission highlighted community broadband and the importance of it. And I think it was Giga Plus Argyle that was mentioned. How important is community broadband in filling the gaps that BT are not prepared to meet? And you know, what is the time frame for rolling out community broadband across the other remote regions of the Highlands?
Okay, so the current arrangements with BT will not get everywhere. And there are discussions about how that might be extended so the fibre can go further. Community Broadband Scotland's critical role is to work with communities who want to develop solutions in areas that the fibre will not necessarily get to. Community Broadband Scotland is up and running. It's open for business. It's already provided or has projects in the pipeline that will cover about 3,500 premises. The Giga Plus or Guile project is important because one of the things we think CBS can effectively do is rather than do hundreds of small projects, and CBS is happy to work with individual communities, but can you aggregate them? And it makes it more attractive to a provider to come in with a technical and a viable business solution. So Giga Plus or Guile covers parts of 7 islands in the Argyll and Islands area, and that's the first of that sort of type of project to go forward. But Community Broadband Scotland is open for business today. It's working across Scotland. It's dealing with, I think, 89 different communities. The challenge it's got, I'll be honest, is knowing exactly where the fibre will finish and where CBS is easy to operate, but that's becoming clearer as modelling has been done. And the next aggregated project will be in Fife, where we've just gone out to do the formal consultation with a view to developing a similar project there.
And my final question is, you have mentioned the Pan Scotland Digital Tourism Programme. Can you say a wee bit more about what that hopes to achieve?
So it's focused on the tourism industry. You know, I can't remember the figure, but a very high percentage of tourism bookings and so on happen online, and then there's an expectation when you get there then things are going to happen online. So it's an expansion of the pilot, and the pilot basically had two components. One was one-to-work support to tourism businesses, advising them how they might develop a digital strategy, and then there was a digital grant available to a number of businesses to actually implement significant step changes in their digital functioning. That's the model that we've piloted with about 60 businesses in the Highlands and Islands, and has now been taking forward nationally. Ourselves, Scottish Enterprise, Visit Scotland, all closely working together on rolling that out.
Thanks so much.
Joan McCallum, is a follow-up on this point? Yeah, please.
Hey, thank you, and can I apologise for my late arrival to yourself and to our witnesses, convener? Just on the aspect of digital, I've been noting the advance that you have been making in terms of broadband. What about mobile connectivity in terms of mobile phones? It's not mentioned, and I wondered if you could say something about the challenges that you have in that area.
So my view is that, and I know this is a view of the Scottish Government as well, that we should have as good coverage on mobile as we are going to have on fixed. But we haven't quite had the same sort of narrative or intervention to support mobile. From a Highlands and Islands point of view, let me just comment. It is the single biggest issue across all of the agencies in the Highlands and Islands. And at the convention of the Highlands and Islands held in Elgin last month, we had all the mobile operators in the room with all the local authorities and all the agencies and so on. And out of that, we've been asked by the Deputy First Minister to try and pull together a coherent way forward for mobile connectivity across the Highlands and Islands, and the Scottish Government digital team working closely with them for the rest of Scotland too. All I would say to you at the moment is I've been having conversations with all of the operators, understanding their coverage plans, what the challenges are in rolling them out, and also working with all the local authority chief executives in the Highlands and Islands to say, but we have a role to play here as well, because there's issues to do with site locations, mast heights, and other sort of things as well. So within a matter of weeks, I will have met them all, and I hope we can be able to pull together a plan that will give some sort of clarity as to how mobile connectivity can be rolled out on a similar, not a similar basis, but to be able to describe it in the way we're able to describe the fibre rollout at the moment. So it's very live and active.
Right. And do you have a budget for that piece of work?
No, I'm doing it myself. I come very cheap. No, myself and my digital team are having, at the moment, I don't mean to be flippant, at the moment it is having the conversations about what's possible, what's going to be required to make the delivery happen. I suspect there's probably some intervention that will be required to actually make the thing happen, but at the moment it is, let's stop complaining that the mobile operators are not covering the Highlands and Islands, because we are always the 5% that doesn't get out there. I have to say, and we've had incredibly encouraging engagement with them and willingness to work with us to try and put together a plan as to how we address the problem.
Right. Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks. If I can follow that up, I'm sure when I met Ofcom recently, they don't have a programme of basically forcing the mobile companies to share masts, is that? That's part of their initiative, isn't it?
Yes, that's part of it, and certainly two of the operators have a joint venture company that are looking at upgrading masts and extending the mast footprint across the UK. So yes, mast sharing is an important part of a way forward.
Yeah. Okay. Can I just follow up one other question that Gordon MacDonald asked about population? I regularly visit Inverness. It's remarkable that the growth in population in Inverness and in the Murray Firth area over the last 20, 30 years. But to what extent has the population growth in the Highlands been concentrated in that area, whereas some of the more remote areas on the west coast and in the far north haven't really seen much growth?
The answer to that is a bit of yes and no. Inverness has grown rapidly, but if you look at percentage population growth, then the Highland Council area, Orkney and Shetland, are way above 10% plus. The Western Isles, this is between the last two census, Western Isles population grew by 4.6% over that period of time. So there have been different rates of growth, but that rate of growth in the Western Isles is similar, I think, to the national rate over that period of time. The one area of our, the one part of our region where population declined between the last two census is the Argyll and the Islands area. And even within Argyll and Islands, then places like Oban grew quite substantially, and other parts, Kintyre and so on, didn't. That's partly what has, or largely what has prompted the creation of the Argyll Economic Forum. Because it's not just an issue there about population decline or young people choosing to leave to study in Glasgow, whatever else, which is understandable. It's the working age population that is actually a challenge there. So there are particular challenges that we're working with Argyll and Bute Council and others around Argyll. But across the rest of the Highlands and Islands, population grew at a local authority level in each of the local authority areas.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Richard Lyon.
Thank you, Convener. I've been sitting listening to you and can say, first of all, happy anniversary. I remember, actually, a number of years ago, seeing a documentary about Highlands and Islands, and what it was like, and your story has moved on since then. Can I ask, before I go on to my other questions, what you're doing to improve your image to the world? Is there anything planned in order to update, a documentary or something to show what you've done in the last 50 years?
We are shamelessly taking the opportunity of the 50s to try and do some of that. So we've done a fair amount of work with the press, to both local, national, and some international press, to get the message out there. Later this month, I've been asked to give the St Andrew's Day lecture in Brussels, so we want to tell the story through these sort of mechanisms. But there's maybe three things I would just mention to you. I'd be very happy to send each of you a book we've just produced, and that tries to tell or to weave through the pages of the book how the history, how the region has evolved, but it tells a story through the eyes and the words of people who are living and working in the region today. So we will use that. The second thing we have is we've produced a timeline. So can I invite you just to go onto our website, and you can just look through the decades and through different themes at what's happened. And again, we'll be using that to promote the Highlands and Islands. And there was a third thing which is gone completely out of my mind. But so we're using the opportunities of media coverage. We're using the opportunities of the book and the timeline. Oh yes, and we're also, the First Minister is introducing a reception which we're hosting here in Parliament, to which you'll have been invited. These sort of things are useful and supplement what we would normally do working with SDI in terms of promoting the region.
Right. I look forward to that, and as I say, I do remember this. It was an excellent documentary a number of years ago. Can I come on to the factor of jobs and also the factor of what exactly, and I'm not taking away what you have done, but you've exceeded all the targets since 2011. Every target you've been given, you've exceeded it, and I compliment you on that. But have you taxed yourself enough? Have you moved it? What are you intending to do as the Chief Executive to promote to your staff to do better? If we go to the factor of targets, most companies have targets. When I worked for the Royal Bank of Scotland, I had targets and it was like carrot and stick. But, you know, how are you moving your staff to, do you have regular meetings with them to say, well, we've done this, we've done that, we've exceeded this, we've exceeded that, let's do better. What are you doing to do better?
So a few thoughts. One is we have exceeded the targets and or met the targets, which I'm delighted. You'll also have seen over the course of that four-year period, the targets haven't remained static either. So some of the ones around turnover growth, around international sales, we've actually increased the target. So we are pushing, you know, staff in that regard. I would have to be honest and say this year's quite a tough year out there. Businesses are finding it more difficult than I think we've seen for some time. And we were just reviewing the half-year position just recently, and you know, we need to push to get some of the targets this year. You know, it's not as easy. So we do that. And each of our business units have their own set of targets which we're asking them to meet and deliver. I think the second thing we've introduced this year is it's not just the numbers, but it's actually making sure that underneath the numbers we're doing enough of the right things. So given the new focus on innovation and internationalisation that's come through the Scotland's economic strategy, then we've invested considerably in both of these activities, and we're asking our staff to do more in those sort of areas. Now, not all of that activity will hit a top-line turnover target very readily, but we want more businesses active in innovation. We want more businesses working towards or active in international trade. So we've developed a number of trackers. You may have seen them in our operating plan. A number of tracker mechanisms or measures or indicators that we are asking each of our business units to make sure we're doing the right things and more of the right things, which will make its way up to the top line targets. But maybe that, does that answer your question or give you a sense of how we're trying to push
things? For the sake of time, I'll do a brief third question. In the review you had, the review confirmed that there are many of your workforce who are meeting and exceeding the expectations of the clients. However, there are others who have some way to go in achieving what is expected of them. The evaluation suggested in some occasions current salaries being paid to some of your staff are not attracting sufficient candidates of appropriate calibre. Can I ask you, do you pay a bonus if someone exceeds their target, and if not, are you considering, looking at current salary scales in order to attract better quality? Not that I want you to sack anyone, but basically to attract or improve the workforce within your organisation.
Okay, so no, we don't pay any bonuses, and we operate within the Scottish Government's pay guidelines. So that's just a given. Let me just say that, and you would expect the Chief Executive to say this, but you know, the staff we have are outstandingly good, and we have experts in the organisation who really are experts in some of the things we do. I think the comment you make, and maybe the source of it, was maybe our account management review of last year, and what that highlighted was, the consultants thought it might be challenging to recruit some people of the requisite skills. I have to say, since that review was done, we've had one or two changes in account management, and some of the account managers we've been able to attract have been outstanding quality, so I'm not concerned with that. The other thing we've done, however, and it links to this, was the review was saying, are you certain you've got your best account managers working with your best high-growth businesses? And what we've done is a major overhaul of account management, where we've if you like, stratified the account management portfolio slightly differently. We now have a smaller number, but of dedicated account managers, match that expertise to, you know, more effectively to the businesses that have that growth potential. So I'm very comfortable with the calibre of staff that we have, as I say, outstandingly good in many cases, but we've managed to align the resource slightly better to the company needs, and that was one of the key recommendations of the evaluation.
Complimenting you on that. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. And lastly, Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Convener. And also apologies for being a bit late. Trains were slightly chaotic in Glasgow this morning. Apologies if I retread anything that you covered before I got here, obviously. It's difficult for all of us to do pre-budget scrutiny. We don't have a budget to look at. That's for you and for us as well. I think we learned yesterday that budget's going to be published just a day before Parliament breaks for Christmas recess. So when we take that home for a Christmas reading, can I ask you what we should be looking for from your perspective, not in the enterprise budget, but in the rest of the Scottish budgets, particularly given that we know cuts are likely to be coming down the line from the UK government, in relation to affordable housing, in relation to education and skills, in relation to transport, the things outside of the enterprise budget, not your own organisation's budget, what are the decisions that we should be looking at to see whether the Scottish government's budget is going to make your agenda more deliverable in the rest of the budget?
Okay. Do you want me to answer that?
Feel free. Well, that's a good question.
Yeah. The thing about economic development is it doesn't happen in isolation from everything else. So, you know, critical things that affect the economic performance of the Highlands and Islands, infrastructure investment. You know, so we've got commitments around the A9, we've got the rail upgrading from Inverness to Aberdeen, but investments in infrastructure are important, and the commitment to, we discussed earlier, the commitment to renewables, because although it may be slightly slower coming through than everybody hoped, then I'm of the opinion there are still huge opportunities for that. We know that housing and affordable housing is a constraint to growth in many parts of the Highlands and Islands. We had a workshop with many partners this week looking around the youth agenda, but access to housing and affordable housing is a major challenge, one of the top five challenges facing young people across the Highlands and Islands. The whole focus around youth, I think, is really important, because we have a demographic challenge behind the good population figure. So things that would encourage, you know, the growth of development of education, the support for the University of the Highlands and Islands, these sort of things off the top of my head would be important.
We know there's unlikely to be more of everything, right? Mm-hmm. So, what, you know, are you able to outline any particular concerns, areas that would be troubling for you, or opportunities that you think the government should be prioritising?
Probably not beyond what I've said. I think, you know, housing and infrastructure are critically important issues for us. Transport networks are vitally important as well, whether it's the ferries or other things as well. So I should probably give a bit more thought and come back with a sensible answer for you. But, you know, these sort of things seem to me to be the obvious ones that impinge on what we do and skills.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Well, that brings us very neatly towards the end of our time. Can I thank both of you for coming along this morning, for answering our questions. It's been very helpful to us. We are now going to have a suspension of the committee for the Remembrance Day commemoration, and we will reconvene at 11:15. Thank you. Okay, if we can reconvene, I'd like to welcome our second panel of witnesses this morning from Scottish Enterprise. We're joined by Adrian Gillespie, who is the Managing Director Operations, Company Growth, Innovation and Infrastructure, and Iain Scott, Chief Financial Officer. Welcome to you both. I've got about until about 12:30 for this session. Can I remind members, if they would, to keep their questions short and to the point, and answers as short and to the point, would be helpful in getting through the topics we want to cover in the time available. I wonder if I could start off and ask you just a process question. We are, as you know, late according to the normal timetable in relation to this year's budget. We've been told the Scottish Government's budget will be published on the 16th of December. I wonder if you can tell us what impact that's going to have on your own budget setting and when you would hope to be in a position to have, you know, a final indicative budget for the coming year available.
I'll take that, Convener. Yeah, it is a bit later this year. We're probably about 1 month behind our normal timetable on that. We would normally be having initial discussions with our board at their meeting in early December, but we're not going to be able to talk about any particular figures then, although we already have had a strategy session with the board, and we've discussed what our priorities would be going forward, and the board's given the executive team some things to think about there to bring back to them as soon as we can do that. So we'll probably be following up on that in early December, but it will be tail end of January before we take a first draft to the board, then end of February board meeting for possibly a final draft, but certainly by the end of March we should be in a position to be able to sign off on that budget.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask you the same question I asked HIE, who were in before you, in relation to the different work streams they have. Are there particular areas of work in the event of the budget, you know, changing, either increasing or perhaps more likely decreasing? Are there particular areas of work which you're more or less likely to be able to flex as a result of budget changes?
We operate very similar, obviously, to Highlands and Islands. I would estimate at this time of year we're normally in the region of about 60% committed towards next year's budget, because a number of things we do are obviously go over the 12-month period. The flexibilities that we have are possibly more on the direct investment side. We invest somewhere in the region of maybe about £60 million into companies every year, and purely just because of the timing of that, those aren't legally committed until the deal is effectively done on that. But that's really important expenditure that we've got. That goes a long way to growing new and quality sustainable businesses. So it's not an area we'd want to reduce, but that's the area of flex that we've got in there at the moment. I think the key thing for us, maybe more than Highlands and Islands, is we've got quite an asset base. I think we've talked about that here before, between our property assets as well as our investment assets. And we have begun to see over the last 12 months a freeing up of the investment assets. So we're getting more returns coming back in there. So actually, I think the job for us is to maximise the income from those assets going forward, as opposed to necessarily reducing the expenditure in the areas that are obviously very important to us.
Mm. I mean, just on that point, I mean, how is that progressing? I think in the current financial year, your ambition was to realise £23 million worth of asset disposals from property. Can you give us a flavour of where you are in relation to that total?
Yeah, I can do that. Our latest estimate, specifically to do with property disposals, is now down to £16.6 million. Main reason for that, though, was there is one deal that we are working on at the moment that initially we thought would happen towards the tail end of this year. It now looks as if that will move maybe 1 or 2 months back into early 16-17, and that deal itself is worth in the region of about £17 million for one piece of land. So as much as that we've had to take it out of this year's forecasts, that's £17 million that we are pretty sure will be a start to next year's income forecast, so it'll go a long way to helping us then. We've managed to still maintain, though, a fairly healthy level in there, because there's another deal that we didn't know about at the beginning of the year, about property in Edinburgh. It looks as if we'll be able to sell before the end of the year, probably in December, for about £10 million, £9.5-10 million. So that's come in to support that. So that's why it's going down that £6 or £7 million. Overall, though, as I say, the investment assets, we've seen more exits coming through there than we originally envisaged. So actually, we've made up that shortfall in the business plan this year with further income from those. So overall, between the two, we're I think we'd originally forecast £29 million of income. We're actually looking about our latest forecast is about 30.5 at the moment. So we're on track for that.
Okay. And have you found, in terms of property disposals, have you found that the market has improved in the last 6 months, a year, compared to previous years?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, particularly the property in Edinburgh, it's a joint property that we've got with Edinburgh City Council. So the return that we're getting on that is certainly more than we would have envisaged at the beginning of the year, certainly more than we're holding it on the books at. So that's really good.
Good. OK, thank you. OK, I'll bring in Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. In our earlier evidence session, we were asking Highlands and Islands about their work within the renewables. We see within your evidence here that it's not in your strategic plan, the renewables. Why would that be?
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to present today. The renewables market has changed a lot over the last couple of years, particularly influenced by policy at the UK level. Some areas that we thought were large opportunities, like offshore wind manufacturing, for example, aren't the opportunity that we thought they were. We're still pursuing specific investments in those areas, but we do see renewables now having reached the stage where there are a number of identifiable opportunities that we will pursue through our existing funding arrangements and through our existing inward investment arrangements. The wave market, as we know, has been particularly difficult, and we've seen the companies in that sector really struggle to attract private sector investment. However, through our investment funds, particularly the Renewable Energy Investment Fund, we're still pursuing some very exciting transformative investments, such as the Maygen tidal flow investment, and the 2B Energy twin blade offshore wind turbine. So we still have those investments that we are pursuing against what is quite a difficult market background.
With reference to that, is it the uncertainty in the market that's making you hesitant in committing more of your budget in this or attracting investors?
It's not so much our hesitance, it's the lack of appetite for private sector investment within particular sectors, or where that the appetite is not as strong as it once was. So clearly that has a knock-on effect for us, because we invest alongside businesses, or we contribute to speed up individual business investments. So that's the big influence on our investment.
How damaging is that in you meeting your sort of carbon emission targets in terms of reducing that?
I guess it's separate, really, in terms of the investments that we would be pursuing. Would in the main be around the employment driver. Offshore wind manufacturing, for example, was around employment, around a market opportunity. There are still other ways of realising our own carbon reduction targets in terms of the companies we support or indeed our own emissions targets. There is obviously, in terms of onshore renewables, there have been some changes in onshore renewables which have more of an effect in terms of the amount that the profile of energy that's generated within Scotland. Having said that, there's not a large amount of manufacturing investment in that sector in Scotland. So I would say that they are separate but connected issues.
Yeah. So you mentioned, obviously, within the UK context, and were you surprised that the recent announcement that Amber Rudd is considering supporting renewables outside the UK when we're actually withdrawing the support within the UK?
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess these are policy issues that don't particularly affect our direct...
It does affect investment, doesn't it? I mean, it's probably a policy issue, but it does affect how you would actually look at attracting investors, investing in an industry, which is obviously an industry of the future.
Clearly, the renewables market and the energy market is very much affected by the policy towards supporting or reducing support within each market. Yes, there is obviously an effect between policy and the stimulation of activity. I guess the kind of most impactful development over the last couple of years has been in the offshore renewables market compared to the opportunity that we thought it was in 2009, for example.
be able to provide a figure for how much you're committed within that renewable sector in terms of budget?
On the budget analysis that we've put in the business plan, you'll see there's two specific lines in there, but renewables and energy gets spread throughout a number of lines, specifically under the internationalisation side, the innovation side. We've got the renewable energy R&D support. We've got that in there at £9.2 million there at the moment. And under the investment side, we've got the Renewable Energy Investment Fund at £18.9 million, so about £28 million in total specifically, never mind the individual company work that we do. I was aware that our REEF team, the Renewable Energy Investment Fund, they've got a work in progress list at the moment that adds up to deals totalling over £100 million, of which we would ordinarily put in about £30 million of that. So there's still a healthy pipeline as regards those renewable investments.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Just to follow up on that renewable energy issue, first of all, the Scottish Government 4 years ago set a target that 100% of renewable electricity would come from of Scottish electricity would be met from renewable sources by 2020. Now, you may have seen a report just out this morning from Scottish Renewables saying that, in actual fact, that's it's likely that the renewable production will fall well short of that at less than 90%. Is that an analysis you agree with? Is that an analysis, or let me put it slightly differently, is that one that concurs with your experience of the shrinking of the market that you've just described?
Okay, thanks, Liz. Well, we've not had the opportunity to review the report, but I've seen the news reports and Neil's statements this morning. I mean, clearly in the 2020 targets, there was a large element of offshore wind was forecast to be part of the energy mix. That market has been much smaller and slower than was anticipated at the time. And clearly there have been changes in the onshore wind supporting the policy support in that area. So I would think there would have to be some very very large reconfiguring of what those 2020 expectations were, so I can imagine that would be a very stretching target at the moment. But I would say that was based mainly on the offshore wind capacity not being what was anticipated at the time.
So I guess in that case you will be looking for opportunities to reverse that contraction of that sector particularly.
Well, offshore wind, there is a long-term market in offshore wind, and we would still be wanting to pursue that market very aggressively. But we had a number of inward investments lined up in onshore wind before the policy, in offshore wind, before some of these policy changes took effect. So we still maintain those relationships, but it's very much a longer-term opportunity now compared to what we thought it was a few years ago.
In the wider picture of energy within the Scottish economy, clearly the biggest difficulty in the last 12 months has been the downturn in the price of oil and gas and downturn in economic activity. Have you made an assessment of the impact of that on economic activity in the Scottish enterprise area?
So our focus has been on supporting those affected by the change in the oil price through the task force that Lena Wilson has chaired, and very much engaging the industry around supporting those affected initially, and also ensuring that, for example, confidence is maintained in areas where there is still opportunity, and also, I guess, looking to the medium and longer term around what has to change within the industry in order to make the North East and the continental shelf activities more competitive within a global market. That's very much been our focus. We've engaged intensively with not just our account managed companies, but companies across the supply chain, with the newly established Oil and Gas Authority, with Oil and Gas UK. There is a very strong partnership actually between industry and the regulator and ourselves around, first of all, understanding the short-term challenges and supporting companies through them, but also looking at opportunities for, particularly for innovation, and how we can get more of the innovation and more of the ideas coming from the supply chain and being adopted by the operators. We feel there are considerable cost savings that can be made by having more of a culture of engagement between operators in the supply chain around sort of transformative innovation that will reduce cost and increase production recovery rates to extend the life of the assets that we have, and indeed encourage more assets to be brought forward. So we're still very much taking a short-term tactical arrangements around support, but also looking to see how this focus on cost can actually be used in a positive way to come out the other side of this much leaner and fitter.
When I asked Highlands and Islands Enterprise a similar question, they did indicate that they were currently undertaking an economic impact assessment on the Shetland economy and the impact of the oil and gas downturn there. But clearly you'll be aware that the impact in the Scottish enterprise area extends far beyond the North East and into the supply chain across the Central Belt. I wonder if you have a view on prospects there, and I'm thinking particularly the case of Bifab has been mentioned to me, a fabricator that operates in both oil and gas and renewables, and particularly offshore renewables, which you've highlighted. Are there prospects for more to be done to enable people with skills and equipment relating to oil and gas to diversify into renewable and other sectors? And if so, how much a part, you talked about a short-term tactical response, is that something that you look at in a more strategic way?
Okay, a couple of questions in there. First of all, in terms of diversification, yes, very much so. We're working with a number of companies on diversification. I would say, though, bearing in mind the comments I've just made about renewables as well, is that we wouldn't be limited to renewables. We would be looking at much wider engineering opportunities than renewables. So, yes, diversification. In terms of, so your second question was around the longer term impact of what's happening at the moment.
I think if the oil and gas downturn and the downturn in offshore wind had happened at different times, there would be more positive things that could be said about diversification from one to the other or back again. I just wonder, in strategic terms, looking into the 2020s, looking beyond this immediate budget, but looking ahead, how you perceive the prospects for those parts of the supply chain that have looked to either or both of these sectors.
Okay, well clearly that will be heavily influenced by the recovery in the oil price. I would say the short-term challenge is the medium-term challenge as well, as about making the UK continental shelf cost base more competitive with other investment opportunities around the world. It is perceived as a high cost base at the moment, and I think there is a big opportunity to use the innovation and the expertise that we have within the sector to make a difference there, which will also establish longer term international opportunities. So the learning that we take from how we are more innovative, how we recover more from aging assets, for example, will be in demand around the world. So we still see a very, very important and exciting opportunity for oil and gas for many, many years to come. And particularly in the areas where we have a specific competitive advantage around, for example, aging assets, structural integrity, that kind of thing. So I think there's very much a shared view between the industry now and the support agencies around where those areas of competitive advantages are. Subsea would be another one, for example, and focusing our efforts on those areas.
On this section, if I could ask, if I refer back to Highlands and Islands Enterprise, I think they told us that they had 80 account-managed companies which were aligned to some degree on the oil and gas sector and with which they were working particularly. Do you have an equivalent total? And if you can give us some idea about what that looks like, that would be very helpful.
Sure, it's 350 companies in the oil and gas sector that we account manage. Our support goes way beyond the account managed companies though as well, particularly in light of recent developments. So working very closely with Business Gateway and with other supply chain partners. So 350, clearly, of our 2,300, it's a very significant amount of our company base. It also is a sector which very much influences our turnover growth targets, our international turnover growth targets. We're already seeing some of our monitoring of turnover growth for this year being affected by what's happening in oil and gas. So it's something that we're very focused on. There is I've mentioned the opportunity for many times to come. There's concern there, and that concern influences the amount of resource and time that we give to the sector at all levels within Scottish Enterprise.
Thanks very much.
Okay, just before we move on from energy, I have a couple of follow-ups. I think Richard Lyle's got a different issue. Well, got a couple of follow-ups on energy. You talked about wider opportunities in engineering in terms of diversification. There was some press commentary I saw a couple of weeks ago at the time of the Chinese Premier's visit around opportunities for Scottish engineering companies from the investment in the new nuclear plant at Hinkley Point in Scotland. Is that something you're actively involved in supporting Scottish businesses in terms of trying to win contracts?
Yes. The nuclear supply chain is something that we've been involved in through our energy team for some time now, mainly around the decommissioning opportunities, but the certification and the expertise around decommissioning can very often be applied to global opportunities in new nuclear. So it would be something that we would be assisting our companies to understand where the opportunity may lie for them. Yeah.
And can you put a figure on that at the moment, or is it too early to say?
Too early to say at the moment. I mean, we have very good relationships with those companies who've been involved in decommissioning because through the support that we've given them. So our routes to those companies would be very straightforward. But no, I don't have a figure on the size of the opportunity, no.
Okay. And secondly, on oil and gas, when you talked about the future of the sector, I mean, is it helpful to have people campaigning to disinvest pension funds from oil and gas? I mean, we get letters about this all the time, as you can imagine. I mean, what message does that send to people whose jobs depend on that sector and people, young people looking to have careers in that sector? Is that sort of thing helpful?
Well, I think perhaps, you know, the question is probably more around what can be done to help stimulate the industry and provide confidence in the industry and provide the right messages to young people about the opportunity that exists and will exist for some time to come. I know where that question's going, but it wouldn't be something that we would take a direct view on. Our priorities is supporting the companies to access both the UK and international markets.
So you're clearly wanting to invest in oil and gas, not see disinvestment.
Sorry?
Scottish Enterprise, you want to invest in oil and gas. You don't want to see disinvestment.
We want to see investment into the oil and gas sector. Okay. It's a very important part of our economy. Yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm sure Patrick Harvey's got a question on this point.
Well, I was going to ask a question about another energy issue, but I'll perhaps just reflect on the warning given by Mark Carney recently about the potential impact on the whole economy if all of our pensions are heavily exposed to an overvalued industry. I think that's the basic argument around divestment. But that's probably a much longer debate, perhaps for another time. One of the commitments on energy that the Scottish Government has given is on energy efficiency. This is to become a national infrastructure priority. And I've seen a number of people try to put a figure on the number of jobs that are involved in that 10-year programme that is likely to develop out of that, which would aim to achieve an impact on every building in Scotland, we're told. There's a range of projections about the amount of work involved, the number of jobs involved. All of them are substantial. I suspect none of them have quite pinned it down yet. Have you been involved in any discussions with the Scottish Government yet about what the opportunities are for businesses in that area to make sure that they've got the skills that they need to do the work that's going to come in and to see how that work is going to be funded, whether that's going to be in the current year's, the upcoming budget, or in the longer term?
I haven't been involved in any direct conversations about that, but Scottish Enterprise is very much involved in the low carbon sector in terms of stimulating innovation. And particularly around opportunities like energy efficiency. So yes, we're very much involved in helping companies in that sector. I guess there are two areas. There are the technologies around energy efficiency, and there's the installation, there's the refitting. We work with companies that are growing in those areas. But there are also a number of companies that are supported by Business Gateway in terms of installation, fitting, I guess more locally based companies. And I know that there has been work in the past to understand the level of capability there and what more needs to be done to I guess, equip those companies with the skills that they need.
Scottish Enterprise isn't yet at the level of discussing with the government what this national infrastructure priority will actually mean in practice for the businesses working in that sector.
Well, I mean, a lot of the support that we give will be relevant to companies in any sector. But you know, in terms of the opportunity around installation, that would be something that Skills Development Scotland would be more involved in, and that we would work with companies through Business Gateway to support those kind of companies. So there's recognition there that this is it's an important priority, and that there are business opportunities there. I guess Scottish Enterprise support is more around companies that would have a wider and international market opportunity around technologies, for example.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Richard Lyon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. My questions are mainly on jobs. I noticed that you put in your submission that your target is to have 5,000 more innovation active companies, 650 million of additional company innovation spend over the next 5 years. How do you propose to do that?
So innovation, key part of our business plan. It is an area where Scotland for some time hasn't measured amongst the best in terms of our global competitors. We've put a lot of focus into this area in recent years. We've got a number of new initiatives that are more focused around driving demand for innovation rather than, I guess, what we've done more of in the past, which has been supporting innovation and R&D projects to help to speed them up or to make them bigger, to make them happen in Scotland. Really, the challenge that we have in Scotland is to increase the amount of demand for innovation. So we're working through supply chains, for example. We're working through an initiative called Seek and Solve, which works with those at the top of the supply chain to understand what their business challenges are, what innovation opportunities there might be in the back of that, and then working with their current and potential supply chain to drive innovation through the supply chain system. Another area where we're very active is in the whole area of open innovation, which teaches companies how to take innovation out with their own company and work more with their supply chain, work more with their, with their sort of wider business contacts around how to make their own company and their own products more innovative. That's something that we've found there's a strong appetite for, but there's actually not a great capability within the company base here for going out with the company and I guess the practices, the ways of going about stimulating innovation more broadly than the your own organisational structures. And we're seeing a very strong demand for that as well. I'm very encouraged by the response we've seen to calls that we've put out to companies to get involved in this programme. And I'm sure we have in the submission that we've got quite high expectations about the number of calls for innovation that are going to come from that wouldn't have happened otherwise. So really our role is stimulating innovation. It's working with companies to make sure that they have got the capacity to innovate. We have a business improvement tool called Improve, which is an EU-adopted diagnostic, which is not about innovation projects. It's more about how ready is the company to innovate, how is the company structured, how engaged are the company's workforce, how much are they dealing with their customers, how engaged are they in markets, and really, I guess, helps companies to prepare to be much, much more innovative to help them to take advantage of some of these projects that are coming forward.
So Scottish Enterprise...
Ian wanted to come in, I think.
I was just to add that I think the best example of the work that we've done over the last few years on that is with the company Alexander Dennis, who make buses. Their Enviro 400 bus model is a prime example of that. They helped us achieve some of the outputs and targets that we were looking for in 14-15 on that, but I think they're now capturing something like 50% of the UK market in buses because of the innovation work they've done in there, never mind the multi-billion pound deal that they may have from the Chinese authorities when they were over recently. So it's a great example of the work that we've done with them that's achieved that.
And they're in my region, so I compliment them on that. But can I again move on to the fact of jobs? We have Scottish Enterprise, the organisation that basically has to drive Scotland's economy and improve and all the other things we want you to do. So let's get out there and get it done. What what are you doing with local, what work are you doing with local councils, local universities, local colleges? We have, you know, people are now saying the population is getting older, skill shortages, there are people who are leaving, you know, so, engineers, we need so many engineers, and we have skill shortages all over the place. What are you as an organisation doing to ensure that Scotland doesn't have a skill shortage in all the places that people are now talking about that we're going to have in the next couple of years with people retiring?
Okay, so we do that in the main through each of the sectors in which we operate. So, for example, in energy, as we mentioned, that a sector which is affected by just exactly that issue. We've been working with Skills Development Scotland, putting together the Skills Investment Plan, the actions that then come from that. And Scottish Enterprise's role in the main would be to help companies to deliver on their skills requirements. So that would be through perhaps support for training. Training Plus is a product that we're deploying much more now than we did in the past. And also through, for example, modern apprenticeship programmes. That's really where the approach that we would take there is to put an account team together around the company. So, for example, GlaxoSmithKline got operations in Irvine and Montrose. We have an account team that doesn't just include Scottish Enterprise, it includes Skills Development Scotland as well, and we've worked with them on some of their skills requirements and also how they can, I guess, work with other companies in the sector around developing their own skills initiatives. So I guess it's about working as a team, Team Scotland. You mentioned local authorities as well. They would be very much part of our account team plans. Local authorities, we've focused much more on our regional engagement really over the last few years. We have location directors that work with each of the local authorities to understand some of their challenges. Just going back to innovation, as I didn't mention as well, I think local authorities in the public sector and the NHS can very much play a part in stimulating innovation, and we have involvement from them in this Open Innovation Programme. So I think a whole range, but for us what's key is understanding each company's requirements, understanding where a sectoral approach can be more beneficial than an individual company approach, and then working with Skills Development Scotland and other partner agencies to help deliver on them.
Okay. Again, if we can just add a wee bit of context to that, as well as those public sector agencies that the agents talked about, actually working with companies to invest in youth is a big theme that we've got at the moment. I think every single company that has accepted an RSA application since the 1st of April this year, and that's 44 companies, have all committed to putting an invest in youth plan together for those companies, and we'll work together with them to ensure that they do that. And I think that's where we want to see more of the investment in young people coming through with the support of the agency that we can give them.
And that's where the business pledge, I think, has been very helpful in stimulating some of these discussions with companies. So, for example, Smiling Cuthbertson and Kilmarnock, they were a recipient of RSA. We had that conversation about having an invest in youth policy. They have an invest in youth policy, but that's also got them into areas of interest like IIP Scotland, and I guess opened up that whole conversation around how a more engaged workforce, highly developed and trained workforce and different workplace practices can actually contribute to the growth of the business.
Lastly, just to the last comment, Kadina, if you allow me, you're going to ensure that we don't have a skill shortage in the next 10 years in all the fields that people are now looking at?
So, look, this is a very fluid situation as well. I guess we will do everything we can to minimise those skills shortages. And industry is very engaged around this issue as well. You know, we have the industry advisory groups. We have within some of those industry advisory groups specific skills subgroups that are putting a lot of focus on this area. We're investing more than we did in the past around areas like Training Plus. So I think there's a strong commitment there from us to minimise those skills shortages. I think you will always have areas of skills shortages because industry is so dynamic. I mean, it's not that long ago we were talking about, you know, the skills shortages in oil and gas and the knock-on impact of that into other engineering sectors. So we have to be quite nimble in terms of how we deal with what are global market changes.
Thank you. Convener.
Okay, thank you. Gordon McDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wanted to move on to the subject of exports, and you quite rightly said that one of the drivers in growth for the Scottish economy is internationalisation. The committee's inquiry on internationalising Scottish business called for more coordination between SDEI, Chambers of Commerce, local authorities in relation to particularly trade missions. What steps are being taken to address joint working?
Okay, thank you. Yes, so there have been some immediate steps taken. So, for example, the community of practice that we referred to in our submission, which is bringing together local authorities, bringing together Scottish Government, bringing Scottish Development International. So we would be striving for, sorry, Chambers of Commerce, I think we'd be striving for a much, much more coordinated approach. And you know, we very much recognise that internationalisation is a strategic priority. It's also a big challenge in terms of moving from where we are now to where our ambitions lie, and that will take involvement from all of our partners. So we very much see this as a Team Scotland and a wider approach as well. You know, there have already been meetings with UKTI you know, I think a better working relationship being established there to coordinate our activities. So, you know, I'm positive about the progress that we've made so far. There's more to be done, and there will be more to be done for some time now in terms of getting to where we want to be around our export and internationalisation targets.
So we're starting to get a more coordinated organisation in terms of trade missions to try and grow the economy. And in your written submission, you also stated the key to future growth lies in increasing the international competitiveness of Scotland's companies and sectors. The companies can do so much. You've talked about the innovation of Alexander Dennis. We've talked about investment, and obviously there's increased productivity. But what I wanted to ask is, what is out with the control of companies? I.e., what effect is the strength of sterling having on the competitiveness of Scottish exports, and what can be done to address that, if anything?
So thank you. Yeah, I mentioned just the need to be nimble in terms of some of the global economic shifts. And you've highlighted one of them there around the strength of sterling and the impact that can have on exports. Yes, it does have an impact on our competitiveness in euro markets. That's still a hugely important export market, and we've still got a huge amount of focus on that. But we are also looking to other markets. So, for example, whilst growth in China isn't what we thought it was going to be, it's still growing very rapidly. The Indian economy growing better than expectations. The US economy, you know, getting back into very encouraging growth. That's a very important export market for Scotland as well. So having I guess that kind of outlook in terms of the advice that we give around those economies where opportunities are increasing, but also looking at the specific sectors. So, for example, in food and drink, the premium food opportunity, very successful, particularly around some of the Asian markets. Oil and gas, you know, there are still opportunities in oil and gas and opportunities in the Middle East, in Saudi Arabia, for example, more opportunities opening up in the Middle East as well. So I guess we just have to be very nimble and very relevant in terms of the advice we give to companies about where those opportunities lie. But again, that will always be a dynamic situation.
Right. And in terms of connectivity, you know, you've highlighted that in growing the economy through exports, it's important we have good connectivity. And that obviously suggests direct flights. So how important are direct flights? And if APD is devolved in a couple of years' time to the Scottish Parliament, how important would be a gradual reduction in APD in growing direct flights and also sustaining jobs here and increasing exports?
Yeah, direct flights are hugely important. We've had quite a bit of success in direct flights, actually, in recent years. There's been a lot of new routes opened up to Canada, for example. We've got a lot more direct routes into Asia, but there's more to be done, and particularly around more direct flights to China, to India, to South Africa. So we're very clear in terms of where we are targeting our resources. We're working very much again as Team Scotland with Transport Scotland, with Visit Scotland on this. And as I say, we have had some successes. Anything that can be done to make the Scottish airports more competitive will be very helpful in stimulating those new routes. So you know, that would be something that we would see as an opportunity to get more direct flights from some of these key emerging markets.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Lewis McDonald.
Thanks very much. And that leads neatly, I suppose, to questions about choices and priorities for enterprise agencies as well as for government. And you have now endorsed the prospect or the principle of inclusive growth as an additional strand to your strategic priorities and to your budgets. One point that might be raised would be to suggest that a budget allocation of 10% is modest. But I wonder if we could start simply by understanding what you understand by inclusive growth and what is it that Scottish Enterprise does or can hope to do in future towards that objective.
Okay, thank you. So in terms of inclusive growth, our focus is very much on the growth element of that. That's what Scottish Enterprise does, is it stimulates growth and growth in those key companies and sectors that we work with. The inclusive element of that is a big opportunity, because what we're striving for by more internationalisation, more innovation, is that we want the economy to be more productive. Now, the inclusion of all of our assets, whether they're people, infrastructure, these are all, you know, the more inclusive we can make that, the more engaged that we can make that system of people skills, then the more competitive and productive the economy is going to be. So it stands to reason. There's also evidence to show that more inclusive economies grow faster. We are very much developing the evidence base. For example, we're involved in the initiatives around business innovation, innovative workplaces, the Strathclyde University, FIT, fair, innovative, transformative workplaces. We're very much working with them to establish the evidence base and good practice. It is an emerging area of work for us. You mentioned the 10%. I think the 10% demonstrates that actually we were active in this. We recognised the importance of good leadership, the importance of regional selection, for example, through regional selective assistance. I would compare it to our spend in other important areas like innovation. You know, I think we're off to a very good start in terms of how that compares to the innovation internationalisation spend. But I guess there's a combination of building on work that we've done in the past around regional selective assistance. I mentioned more deployment of Training Plus, particularly in light of some of the changes to RSA, to regional aid that were made at the European Union level last year. That encourages us to use training as more of a tool in terms of attracting investment. Iain mentioned our investment in youth and the work we've done around RSA and investment in youth. We are quite encouraged by some of the signs that we've seen around the involvement of women and minorities in terms of the new engagements that are being made with Scottish Enterprise and Business Gateway over the last few years. So, for example, in terms of new business engagements that we've made, we're seeing about 47% of them now being made by women, and that's almost double what we've seen in the past. So it is very much about making sure that all of Scotland's assets are working together to have the most productive, engaged economy that we can possibly have, and that will make us more internationally competitive.
I guess, to be fair, you have a different remit from Highlands and Islands Enterprise, which I'm sure you'll comment on, but when I asked them about inclusive growth, they talked about geographic and social and digital. And I think while clearly leadership development, entrepreneur support and encouraging investment are all things that are good things, they're not. I'm not sure I see them as particularly inclusive, certainly not in a social sense. Is the fact that your remit does not include a specifically social remit mean that when you talk about inclusive growth, you're simply talking about growth and trying to be inclusive and promoting it?
Adrian, it's not that is not focusing us away from that. If anything, I mean, there are many areas of our activity that go across the whole of Scotland. One particular one is our investment function, so through Scottish Investment Bank, and we talked about the REEF Renewable Energy Fund earlier on. That fund's invested $2.25 million in a community wind farm in Stornoway, going towards a £14 million project up there for a 9 megawatt wind farm. So, you know, there is examples where we are doing that, Lewis, maybe because our wider focus is more on the growth side of things. Maybe that's why it comes through maybe more strongly in there, but it's absolutely the types of things we do as well.
Could I also mention, though, in terms of, you mentioned regional engagement, a couple of points to make on the way that we actually kind of capture this spend, that inclusive growth is not just influenced by the budget line that we have for inclusive growth. Inclusive growth is hugely influenced by things like innovation, internationalisation. There's a direct link there. So, for example, many of the companies that we work with around things like leadership very much leads to inclusive growth. I think it's essential that if we're going to have engaged workforces, for example, innovative workplaces, that we've got organisations that are well-led. So I would argue there's a very strong link there. In terms of regional engagement, though, our investment in the Dundee waterfront, substantial £33 million investment in the Dundee waterfront, is absolutely based on understanding that there is an opportunity there to have a stronger economy. So this is an economy which, you know, for many years has had lower growth, lower employment rates, higher unemployment rates. The waterfront investment is about transforming some of those kind of key economic indicators. So we are very much involved at a regional level. I'd also mention the city deals as well that we're very much involved in. I'm involved in the Aberdeen city deal in terms of our leadership, sponsorship of that piece of work, very engaged with the local authorities and pulling together that, and in fact actively contributing around the innovation and internationalisation themes and using our expertise to inform the bids that are put in for the city deal. So I think there's a lot of this going on that wouldn't necessarily be captured in budget lines.
And I guess that's part of my concern, is that I'm not sure the budget line is particularly helpful in illuminating the work you're doing. And I completely take the point you make that good economic development can have good social outcomes. But as an agency, you're not particularly in a position to implement social policy. And I guess I'm looking to see if there are any policy directions in which you are going now, because you now have a strategic priority of inclusive growth that you weren't pursuing before, before that was added to your list of strategic priorities.
So I think what we can bring is, a couple of things. We can bring a strong knowledge of the growth opportunities that can help our partners in terms of the specific social inclusion initiatives that they're working on. I'm thinking of things like through the community planning partnerships and their involvement and engagement about the opportunity there. The other area that we're very much involved is about raising ambition, something that we've discussed in Dumfries and Galloway, for example. We're involved in Fife, is about how can we accelerate ambition that will lead to changes in some of the economic indicators that we would like to see in a different place. So, you know, I think we're a very important part of the effort around social inclusion. We bring a specific expertise to that, and we very much, I would expect us to be informing those policy decisions, if not leading on some of them. Yep.
Finally, if I may, Iain mentioned that 44 companies since the new financial year had accepted that they should have a youth policy as part of the conditions, or at least in connection with the receipt of a regional selective assistance. That's not a formal condition, is it? And my question is, are there other requirements put on recipients of funding through Scottish Enterprise? And are any of those conditions formal requirements that relate to the social policy? As
we do take the approach of encouraging and incentivising rather than I guess regulating around some of these matters. And I think those 44 companies, I think that demonstrates that approach can be quite effective. The feedback from our RSA team is that they've actually been, there's not been any resistance. In fact, the opposite, that companies have welcomed these conversations and have put in place practices that they wouldn't otherwise have done. So I think that demonstrates that approach will probably take companies along with you on conversations that you're introducing about, you know, how engaged is your workforce, how could that be changed. So that would very much be our approach. For example, in youth employment, we would go further in terms of our support if there was a youth employment dimension. So for example, in organisational development support, I think an example would be stevedoring in Forthports. By encouraging them to take on more youth, we would actually go slightly further in terms of our contribution to some of those projects. So it is about incentivising, encouraging, using the evidence base that we have and that we're continuing to build about why taking this approach is actually more beneficial to the company and to the economy.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Patrick Harvey, got a follow-up?
Yeah, on this inclusive growth agenda, which I have to admit I'm struggling with a bit as well to see that it's any change of direction. It doesn't seem to me any more meaningful a concept than sustainable growth was. They both sound pretty much like vanilla GDP growth to me. But your answers on this theme didn't mention the business pledge. Your written evidence does. It says as part of your approach to this inclusive growth agenda, you're actively promoting the Scottish Business Pledge, and around 30% of signatories to date are account-managed companies. Would you mind just putting that statistic round the other way? What proportion of your account-managed companies have taken up the Business Pledge?
Okay, so it would be in the region of, I mean, it would be a low proportion of our account-managed companies.
How many account-managed companies are there?
We've got 2,300
account-managed companies, and
yes.
What? A few dozen of them have signed the business
pledge? There's 40, I think 39 or 40. Yeah.
Okay. So,
But it's early days, Patrick. No, I think it's early days in terms of that conversation. I mentioned earlier the business pledge, how useful it was in terms of opening up discussions with companies about this whole area. And it has been, you know, let's look at the living wage, the number of companies that have formally signed up to living wage. That's 300. So we're up to over 100 in the business pledge already. And that's only after a few months. So I think that's quite encouraging in terms of the active
participation.
I'm not
trying to be scathing here, yeah. But after a few months, you're somewhere around 1%, perhaps a little bit more than 1% of your account managed companies have signed the business pledge, which is the first step in a journey toward more ethical business practices, and again about raising ambition, as you mentioned, this is very much part of that agenda. The Scottish budget is about to vote you another year's funding. You're going to have opportunity to use that, to use the public money that's given to you to drive that figure up, to drive up the number of your account managed companies who have committed to the business pledge. Where would you expect it to be by the end of the financial year that this coming budget will relate to?
Well, I would hope to continue to see the sort of progress that we've seen. We're having those conversations with companies. I don't want to put a figure on it, really, because this is about engaging. It's not about, I don't think, setting a target and trying to tick boxes. This is about opening up conversations with companies about these important areas. So I would hope to see continued progress. We've discussed it. The conversations have begun with companies. We've discussed it with over 1,000 of our account managed companies now. So I would hope, we've got more companies in the pipeline, I think another 20 companies in the pipeline looking to be assessed for the business pledge of our account managed companies. So we're seeing that pull through. There are also a number of companies who are already involved in areas like the living wage, and some of the other themes such as innovation, internationalisation, that are actually very happy to participate in these without signing up to the business pledge. I guess there will be some companies that will get engaged in that conversation that won't necessarily sign up for their own reasons. But I would expect to see progress.
You've begun that conversation with 1,000 of your account managed companies. It would be reasonable then to say that all of them would have been approached to take part in that conversation by the beginning of the financial year that this budget relates to.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Yeah.
Would it be a reasonable expectation then that public money that's being spent through Scottish Enterprise is one of the incentives, if companies want to access support services that are coming through you, or indeed access grants, that this would be one of the incentives that's put in place to ensure that people take the business pledge seriously and sign up?
Yeah, so for example, we are taking moves in that direction. So for example, we know that we get a better return where companies have a mix of support that includes innovation, internationalisation, and some element of organisational development as well. We see the returns within companies being higher. There's a good argument there for us, therefore, to go further in terms of our support to encourage more companies to undertake that kind of initiative. So we will incentivise, we'll continue to find ways to incentivise companies to get involved. Yeah.
So you will put in place incentives and presumably disincentives in relation to the business pledge?
Not disincentives. I think it would always be about encouragement. Winning the argument through the evidence base that we have and through the evidence of the impact that it's had on other companies that we work with. So sometimes that will be about more money. Sometimes it will be about more attention from us in terms of the resources that we put in through our organisational development team, which we are growing and which we are who are coming up with a lot of good new initiatives around this whole area. So I would expect us to be doing more in this area and using means at our disposal to encourage companies to do what the evidence points to is a more productive way of doing business.
Just an example on that one. I mean, a company that the OD team has worked with, Genius Foods, they're in the gluten-free bakery market. A small company with 20 people in it, but did a couple of acquisitions, so they're up to about 400 people. So we want to be close to them with the growth ambitions. They, from the work that we've done with them, we've helped put training programs in place that's increased their spend on training of their employees from £82 a head up to £300 a head. We've also got them to look at their overall pay and benefits package, which has significantly increased that for individuals in there. But they've still got an objective to achieve the living wage. You know, so if there was conditionality in there that said we couldn't work with them because they weren't signed up to the pledge because it weren't at living wage, we wouldn't have been able to work with those companies. So there's still a lot of work that we need to do to get companies by encouraging them to have better progressive employment practices than making it conditional. So that's not our policy at this time to do
we
that.
We all accept that it's about moving people along in a journey.
Yeah.
But that movement has to happen, and perhaps some of these questions could be followed up with the Cabinet Secretary at the end of the pre-budget scrutiny in relation to the arguments for conditionality.
Hmm. Can I just follow up just on that last point, Mr. Gillespie, because this whole question of conditionality is one that the committee spent quite a lot of time looking at in terms of our recent inquiry. And unless I misheard you, you said something in relation to incentives and the business pledge, and you said some of this will be about more money. So are you actually saying that Scottish Enterprise will offer to help businesses who sign the business pledge when it wouldn't offer to help businesses who didn't?
What I'm saying is that where companies get involved in some of the areas that are that are pointed to in the business pledge, like innovation, internationalisation, where we know there's an impact, that we will go further to encourage companies to do that, not specifically to sign the pledge, but to get involved in some of those activities. But the pledge is a very good way of introducing these conversations to companies and getting that on the agenda. So, it wasn't specifically about incentivising the pledge. To sign the pledge would be incentivised. It would be about undertaking, because the pledge was based on evidence that we have about what works in terms of making the economy better.
All right. Thanks for clarifying that. Okay. Joan McAlpin.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm glad you mentioned Dumfries and Galloway, Adrian, because I'm going to raise it again, as I have done in the past in committees and obviously with both of you privately. I think it relates to the 2.1 section of your written evidence on supporting Scotland's companies. And I've obviously raised the subject of Duthie and Galloway before because we don't have a huge number of companies of the size that you use to account managing, and also because in many ways it's not a city region and it's more like areas of the Highlands and Islands in terms of the support it needs. So I guess I'd like you to tell me, you know, how you've changed your practice in the region to improve things, and also this differentiated approach that you mention in your evidence. Could you maybe in the context of that talk a wee bit more about that and how you're measuring it?
I'll bring in Iain in a minute. Iain has specific responsibilities for the south of Scotland. But conversations that we had about increasing ambition, about working closer with Business Gateway and understanding what will work in terms of increasing ambition levels and trying to get more companies pulled into the account management system. We've also, our employees have been very much involved in terms of coming up with new ideas about what would work for the economy, and have held specific workshops to develop new project ideas about, for example, in the dairy space, around how we can help to stimulate the economy. We've got some specific ideas about the regeneration of Annan and around the kind of decommissioning of the power station there and what other uses we might be able to put that to. So I think quite a lot of focus on that. I would say that you mentioned the business space as well. A big part of our work in Duthie and Galloway has been provision of business space to allow companies to grow and to pull more companies into that growth system. So I think there's been a lot going on, but I'll maybe bring Iain in at this point.
Thank you.
Thanks, Adrian, to cover most of the things that I could say about Dumfries and Galloway there, but you maybe know, John, I was down at Dumfries and Galloway Business Week recently, and it was great to meet a number of companies that were down there on several occasions. One account managed company was fantastic at demonstrating the growth that they've had down there. So we do need to try and get more companies with that level of support. I think there is about 20 companies in the growth pipeline, as we call it, at the moment, and we need to be progressing them through. I think Adrian's given a commitment in the past to the council down there that we will look at moving companies into our account managed programme, even if they weren't meeting the hard criteria that we've put in the past in there. I think we've made some movement on that. I think there's two or three companies that we've maybe looked at doing over the last 6 months in there.
So you would consider doing that even if they didn't meet? Absolutely, we
recognise some of the issues down there, and we will act flexibly on that. We won't say we'll set other criteria, but we'll act flexibly for quality businesses that are in that growth pipeline to get them through into account management sooner.
And when you say you work more closely with Business Gateway, what does that mean in practice, and how does it change things?
Well, I certainly saw a lot of evidence down there of really close working. I think there was one presentation night where there was a lot of companies along there, and a number of the agencies all stood up and were all speaking with one voice about how they work together in there, particularly all of them, including two or three areas from my own organisation that were saying to all the companies that were around, if you need to access any support or you think you need some access and support, go and contact the Business Gateway because they are the front line for us. We work very closely with them and we'll be able to deliver the services to you, but the Business Gateway is absolutely at the front of that. I think the council have actually just recently taken the Business Gateway into their own ownership down there, and we've certainly got a very good relationship with the council down there now. I think that's progressed over the last 12 months or so, but we'll work very closely with them to help companies.
Okay, that's good. In terms of, I don't know if you heard when I asked at the previous session with Highlands and Islands Enterprise about the whole issue of mobile connectivity. Obviously, there's been a big emphasis on broadband, and I think it's fair to say we're making headway in both the Highlands and the south of Scotland in broadband. But access to mobile coverage, as the Highlands and Islands Enterprise said, it was the most important issue for people in the Highlands. And I would say that in my region, it's probably one of the most important issues as well. Have you had the kind of conversations with mobile operators that the chap from HIE mentioned in his evidence?
I don't think we have had that yet, but particularly for that area, the south of Scotland, I sit on the South of Scotland Alliance alongside Dumfries and Galloway Council and Scottish Borders Council. And at the last meeting, there was a number of discussions about both areas there still, Joan, both broadband and particularly mobile as well. And we're going to work together as a group to try and progress that. So it'll come through the South of Scotland Alliance working in conjunction with the councils to make representations to whoever can do something about that down there. Broadband has had some progress down there, but there's still quite a lot of coverage that needs to be done as well, and we're going to work hard to do that too.
I think what we did, Joe, is that I have been leading on broadband implementation. I think there might be some lessons we can learn from the approach and the expertise that they've got in-house that we might be able to apply to some of the locations that you mentioned this morning, and some other locations that we know about that could maybe benefit from some input from that. So we'll take that up.
Good, that's good. I thought it was interesting that the Chief Executive said it was a piece of work that he personally was taking forward at HIE, and he had been asked to do it by Mr. Swinney, and it might be helpful if there was something similar that we could do in our area.
We'll certainly make sure he's got access to the south of Scotland and the rest of Scotland to continue that work that he's going to do for you, John. Yeah.
Right. Okay, thank you very much.
I think that's called passing the buck. teamwork, thank you. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. As a politician, you come across people who want to do things in Scotland, and there are two aspects that jump out at me, and I want to ask you if there are any more. One is planning, getting, you know, people putting in an application and not being passed or whatever, and the time it takes to get planning and the time to get Section 75 ordered, etc., etc. And the other is funding, you know, investment to try to get, locally, I mean, I think the Green Investment Bank has only spent 4% of their funding in Scotland. But is there any other, if you'd like to comment on maybe those two aspects, and are there any other aspects that you have come across that you think we should be looking at in order to improve economic activity in Scotland?
Okay, specifically on planning, I mean, we on an individual basis with companies will work with them where they've got planning concerns, and that we will use our relationships with local authorities, for example, to assist with that. I think the other area is utilities as well, which comes up as sometimes a frustration for companies, or in terms of implementation time, or in terms of actually kind of inhibiting growth. So that would be another area. Again, we would tend to take that up individually with the relevant company or local authority that would be involved in that. And we do that often. That will be below the radar, and we will try and sort that out and remove any barriers. But that would be the other area that would spring to mind in terms of sometimes getting in the way of investment or slowing it down. Sorry, was there another question there around the Green Investment Bank?
You've got the Scottish Investment Bank continuing to address both supply and demand issues, companies seeking finance. You know, basically, are banks now starting to lend? You know, are you involved with companies that they say, oh, it's easier, I can talk to my branch manager and she wants to give me money now? Whereas before, years ago, it was no.
Can I try and respond to that? I've been working alongside the government team on the Scottish Business Development Bank, so we've been speaking to a number of the banks out there for that. I think it's clear banks are lending, but there are still some areas that they find difficult to lend to, and that's what we're trying to work with them to come up with some kind of products that will allow that to happen. So whether that's some co-investment or some guarantee or something, we're working on that at the moment, and hopefully over the course of the next few months we'll be able to come out and announce something on that. It's certainly happening. I think the biggest area that we're investing in is through our access to finance team. So as well as the work within SIB, as well as giving out money alongside other co-investors, we actually have got a team dedicated to working with companies to help them put proposals together in a way that they've got a better chance of accessing finance. And over the last couple of years, we've been very successful in that, to the point where I think we doubled the resources we're putting into it, and we're going to expand that even further as a result of the work on the Scottish Business Development Bank. We're also going to look at how or making it easier for companies out there to be able to find out and access, so some kind of digital solution to be able to pull some of these products together to make it easier to do that. We're looking at doing at the moment as well. So we've made progress, but there's still some way to go on that.
Thank you, Kildare.
Ms. McDonald's got a follow-up.
Slightly going back to the wider question of the economic impact of the oil and gas downturn, and we talked about that earlier on. You talked about a short-term tactical response and the importance of that. There are further figures out today which show that the claimant count over the last 12 months in Aberdeen is up by 39% and in Aberdeenshire by 66%. These are very significant figures, I'm sure you'll appreciate. Is it time to assess the impact of this on the North East regional economy and on the Scottish economy? Is this something that Scottish Enterprise can take a lead on in the way that Highlands and Islands Enterprise is doing in Shetland?
Okay. So I would argue we're very much taking a lead in terms of the response. Look, this is something we'll give consideration to, Lewis, in terms of whether there's a piece of work to be done here. I think we very much appreciate the kind of scale of what's happening here, and I think we're doing all of the right things. I'm not sure putting numbers on it actually at the moment is actually going to be particularly helpful. I think we're very much focused on the task at hand and also what needs to be done for the future. We have the oil and gas strategy, which is being refreshed at the moment, which very much recognises some of the changes that have taken place. So there's a huge amount of effort going on there. Whether it would be worth partnering with HI in terms of looking at the impact more widely is something that we'll take away and follow up with you. Yep.
Okay. Right, I think that's it. Okay, on behalf of the committee, can I thank you both for coming along and spending your time. It's been very helpful to us in our deliberations, and we will now suspend briefly and go into private session.